The final sort of discipline associated with the manipulation of data as a set, it would be to produce aggregates and aggregated structures, very often used for querying, for export in small data marts, or very often within the data warehouse, or for use in reporting and those sort of things. So the generation of the aggregations usually involves reading a large amount of data, potentially joining it to other structures, and then segmenting, sorting and grouping the data according to some of the columns that we've defined. This process again takes CPU and can be either done manually, or we can use, you know, core parallelism within the database in multiple ways. And I'm going to do it the same techniques. I'm going to run some races, and we're going to bake them all off the techniques against each other. And, you know, we're going to run the race. And this one's a little bit more interesting compared to the other one, in that you'll notice that the way things are running, that the homegrown parallelism hasn't actually done that well. You'll notice that the set-based processing took about 10 seconds, whereas an estimated time for the row-by-row processing of about 2.5 hours. And you'll notice by the time we stopped, the homegrown processing hadn't really achieved much. Now, this is one of the challenges you have with trying to code your own parallelism in. Very often the startup costs and figuring out the date ranges and all that sort of stuff has a fixed overhead, and so you have to do a certain amount of work before the work can actually start in earnest to do the work in parallel. So what we've learned on this one is to actually apply a little bit of a delay, such that what we do is if we rerun the race, we'll actually wait 25 seconds before the set-based parallelism proves that solution starts work. And we'll let the others get to work. And you'll notice the homegrown parallelism initially didn't do anything, and now it's starting to pull quite a long way ahead. And it's certainly, we haven't even started the set-based parallelism because we kept him waiting 25 seconds. And you can see that the homegrown parallelism was way ahead of the parallelism and the array processing. But look, the set-based processing is starting to catch up, and it looks like it's almost tied. Nope, but it still wins, even if you've given it a head start of 25 seconds to all the other techniques. So again, it teaches you another lesson about homegrown parallelism. There's usually quite high startup costs or configuration costs. The characteristics of the system, pretty much as I showed in the other cases, where the array and row-by-row processing was just using a single core. The homegrown parallelism very often using a lot more CPU and getting the machine a lot more busy than the set-based techniques, because it's running effectively serial algorithms in parallel rather than running parallel algorithms, which, as you can see, as soon as they start, they almost finish because they're over and done with. So we aggregated 101 million rows, and you can see it just happened so quickly in 10 seconds. By the time it was up to full speed, it was time to finish. Whereas the other techniques, so homegrown parallelism, it made the machine look busy, but it was an inefficient program running in parallel. And again, that's the other big challenge we face with people who effectively try to convert serial programs into multi-threaded parallel programs. They're still not using good set-based mechanics or set-based algorithms to execute the code. They're just using the inefficient row-by-row stuff. It's just happening in parallel, which means you're wasting a lot of CPU. And the other thing we tend to see that is, again, high startup costs, and there's a fair chance that they're going to contend with each other. If this was an operation that was updating common tables, you may find that there's contention in those tables or contention on the indexes on those tables as you manipulate them. So you can see there are challenges with trying to implement your own parallelism. So let's just have a quick look at the code just to do that, and we'll be very quick through those. The row-by-row program, if you want to scroll through it, you can see what it's actually doing is we've written a whole set of procedures that keep running totals inside the PL SQL program and are incrementing counters as we go through each key. So the counting's being done effectively in the application code, and this is potentially an inefficient way, but we tend to see people doing this sort of thing, particularly if they're using conventional inserts and they're worrying about the data sets becoming so big that they're going to cause rollback segments to explode and things like that. So they actually break down the DML components or the inserts into smaller chunks. And so by doing that, they basically force themselves into doing running totals inside their programs. Very often these are programs that have been converted from old procedural code that may have been working on flat files. And so the original versions of the programs didn't even have the concept of relational operators and set-based techniques in the language, and so we've just inherited all these old counters, and basically they've used the database to grab data and push it back. I can describe, and there's not much to be seen from basically the programming in the array techniques. Again, we're using array techniques to grab and push the data away. We've been slightly different on the home programmer. Instead of using the aura hash, well, we have used the aura hash, but we're sending the rows as we send them back, and we're pipelining them through a table function to get the parallelism through a table function so that basically everything can be computed as a series of streams. But really the one that's the most interesting one and the most important one is to look at the simplicity of the set-based solution, which is basically an insert of a query and some group bys, where all the running totals are done for you. And some of these grouping functions, very often you need windowing functions to segment the data in the format that you need. But again, we're pushing everything down into the core parallel engine inside the database. And as you can see, there's huge performance gains. Again, it's all in each case, we wrote less code. It may be argued that the code is harder to write, but look at the performance and let the performance of the situation speak for itself. We're talking 10 seconds versus 2 hours. This is a huge performance difference. And again, a good engineer, once they've learned to exploit these set-based techniques and they see the performance gains, they can actually start to innovate business processes to run semi-real time or much faster and get rid of these ludicrous batch jobs that run for 6 or 7 hours every night and become really quite stressful for many people, because if they fail in the middle of the night, they may never catch up the following night. And so again, set-based techniques not only are faster in terms of performance, using less system resources and more efficient, but it makes your whole business process more robust and less frightening and takes the risk out of manipulating and managing large data sets. And it's really a case of just understanding large data sets take specialist programming techniques, and when applied effectively, they can perform just as well as small data set problems. It's a case of just learning the right tools to do the right job.